Welcome to The Kill Count, where we tally up the victims in all our favorite horror movies. I'm James A. Janisse, and today we're looking at Spiral from the Book of Saw, released in 2021 after a year-long delay due to COVID. Spiral is the ninth film in the Saw franchise, but according to the filmmakers, it's not a Saw movie. It's not a strict reboot either, everything that happened before still happened, but it's a sort of standalone film, a new chapter, from the Book of Saw. Those familiar with Saw know that the first seven films were one unbroken Byzantine story. And I loved it. The eighth film, Jigsaw, was a bit of a soft reboot, ignoring most of the convoluted lore, but still focusing on John Kramer, the Jigsaw Killer. Although Spiral acknowledges Kramer's existence, it has an independent storyline friendly to new viewers. You don't need to see the first eight films to enjoy it. In fact, I'd say Spiral buries John Kramer, five films after we saw him die. Rest in peace, you sanctimonious bastard. Though its story is disconnected, Spiral was made by Saw veterans, including several producers who have worked on every single film. Darren Lynn Bousman was hired to direct, returning to the franchise after a four-film absence. While James Wan directed the original Saw, Bousman took over to do Saws 2, 3, and 4, meaning he solidified the Saw look and style, which he brings to Spiral with some alterations that make it feel more modern, like having songs on the soundtrack by 21 Savage. Bousman clearly loves the series, and it's to Spiral's benefit that he returned and made it look congruent with the other films. Also returning to the franchise are screenwriters Josh Stolberg and Peter Goldfinger, who wrote Jigsaw. They had been writing Jigsaw 2, which would have delved into more John Kramer backstory, when Saw producers Mark Berg and Oren Coles told them to drop everything they were doing. Chris Rock had mentioned that he'd love to do a Saw film, and Lionsgate Vice Chairman Michael Burns said, let it be so. Only 6 months after Rock pitched the idea at a birthday party in Brazil, a script was written. Rock, who was also an executive producer, wanted a Saw movie that combined police procedurals with bits of humor sprinkled in, something like a cross between Seven and 48 Hours. He told the writers to write a straightforward Saw movie and that he would provide all the comedy.
Don't give me a draft where you're writing me a line that you think is funny. I'll take care of that part.
Though there are plenty of funny moments, and the comedy isn't overdone, a lot of Rock's humor falls flat for me. The rest of the screenplay is even worse. While cop plots have always been a part of the franchise, they usually only take up half the film, with the other half devoted to sick and twisted trap plots. In Spiral, the cop plot is the whole kit and caboodle. I like that it deals with police corruption, especially since it was made before the summer of 2020. Because of that, it doesn't feel like it's trying to exploit a hot topic. Still, it doesn't engage with that theme in any meaningful way, and the characters and story beats are cliche and uninteresting. In fact, as it goes on, Spiral becomes the unthinkable, a boring Saw movie. Full disclosure, Chelsea and I promoted Spiral when it first came out, with a video highlighting five things we loved about the movie. I stand by those five things and everything I said in that video. We wouldn't lie to you. But I'll admit, I'd have had a hard time coming up with a sixth item, because outside of the strengths we talked about there, I wasn't a fan of this movie. Maybe I'm just too attached to the first six films and the soap opera they spawn. But Spiral ultimately left me disappointed and wanting more for my beloved Saw. No matter how connected it is to the rest of the series, a Saw movie's gonna have tons of gore. That's why today's episode is sponsored by Bright Cellars. We're halfway through spooky season, but other holidays are right around the corner. As good a reason as any to stock up on wine. Especially when you can count on the wine being tailored to your personal tastes. A quick little wine quiz helps Bright Cellars determine the best bottles to send to you, and it only gets better the more you use them. I rated my previous bottles, and the ones I got this time around were even tastier. As always, their selection included informational cards, allowing me to learn while I imbibe.
Knowledge.
You can get four bottles conveniently delivered to your door in packaging that's completely recyclable and plastic-free by visiting the link in this video's description. There, you'll take the wine quiz and get 60% off your first order. That's a huge savings. Just follow the link in the video description to take their simple quiz and get started. Much like the Necronomicon, the Book of Saw is probably written in blood. Let's see what our ink supplies look like and get to the kills. The movie begins with fireworks. Hide your dogs and trauma, y'all! Some straw-hatted mofo is walking around a carnival when he sees a guy in an Uncle Sam getup steal a woman's purse. Can never trust those Uncle Sams, always trying to steal and or murder. The man who looks like he's vacationing in Cuba reveals himself as police, Detective Boswick. He chases the thief through the crowd in a scene they had to shoot guerrilla style, since they never got a permit to film at this actual carnival. Boswick winds up in a tunnel underground where the star-spangled suspect transforms into a hunky hunk of plastic. Boswick gets bagged and wakes up with his hands bound. Oh, and also, his tongue's in a vice. And he's in a subway tunnel. Not a great sitch, but there is a TV. Maybe it's got Netflix, dude.
Hello, Detective Boswick. I want to play a game.
Nah, this seems more like a Hulu show. It's a pig in a robe with a jigsaw-like tape, but with a noticeably new voice.
It is up to you to decide if this will be your final stop.
The filmmakers considered using Jigsaw's voice, but rightfully determined that it wouldn't make any sense, seeing as how that dude's been dead for over a decade now. They ended up going with a computer-generated voice, which I actually like. It's off-putting. Good to be back in the old Saw trap again, if we're being honest. Feels like a warm horror hug. Boswick, a crooked cop, can save himself by dropping and letting his lying tongue get ripped out. Otherwise, say hello to Train. You all know what happens next, folks. This is shot like a saw trap, it bleeds like a saw trap, and eventually it kills like a saw trap. Boswick does drop from the ladder, but too late to save himself, so I'd say he got the worst of both worlds if you stop to think about it. If this trap seems simpler than some of those from the other Saw films, that's intentional. After all, John Kramer was an engineer and could design elaborate torture devices. The new Jigsaw copycat killer doesn't have that expertise. The traps had to make sense, and as always, be built in a way to work in real life.
Then they go to engineers, literal engineers, to figure out, would this really work?
They couldn't shoot in a real subway tunnel, so they faked it with forced perspective. Those are matte paintings back there, with minor visual effects added to help sell the trick. It's also the same background for both directions of the scene. When they needed to get the opposing angle, they just turned actor Dan Petronievich around. He had to bite down on a fake tongue to hold it in place, and since that made his mouth look big, more visual effects were used to make it look normal-sized. Finally, visual effects were used for the subway train and to make the moment of impact happen. The digital effects team was led by John Kampfins, who's worked on the franchise since Part 3. The practical effects, like Boswick's prosthetic head, were made by Francois Dagenet, who's been with the series since Saw 2. Dagenet has also worked on Hannibal, made the Tooth Child from Channel Zero, and recently did effects on the new Chucky series. What a legend! Chris Rock plays Detective Zeke Banks, who likes to go undercover so he can practice his stand-up.
Who the fuck is nicer than Forrest Gump? His best friend was a nigga and a white boy with no legs.
As mentioned, Rock wrote all of his own comedic lines, and in this opening scene, he was going for a Reservoir Dogs Like a Virgin kind of conversation. Doesn't really work for me, but I like the 21 Savage song playing. When he's not stinging criminal operations that were already about to get stung, Zeke's at the police station getting yelled at by Captain Garza. She's played by Marisol Nichols, now famous for Riverdale, but who had a small role in Scream 2 when she first got started. That's fun. Even though his dad used to be chief of police, Zeke's an outcast among the officers for breaking the blue wall of silence.
12 years ago, I turned in a dirty cop.
Since then, everyone hates him for being a so-called rat. He hates them right back. You can tell by the whip-smart dialogue.
Fuck you.
No, fuck you!
Garza assigns Zeke a partner, rookie detective William Shank, played by Max Minghella. The pairing is quite an honor for the young lad.
Your dad's the reason for all of this. He's why I wanted to do this in the first place.
Shank is subjected to more Chris Rock stand-up as they head to the subway crime scene in a great long one take that even goes down a bunch of stairs. Love the shot, don't love all of Rock's jokes.
Women cheat in the daytime. You can ride a lot of dick before dusk. Mm-hmm.
They find the splatter and tongueless remains, but don't learn that they belong to a fellow officer until Zeke gets a robin egg blue box with a beat up USB drive inside. Yeah, just plug that thing into a computer on the police station's network. That's great cybersecurity. A voice tells Zeke that it's going to help him clean up the police force. The cops recognize the spiral in the video as Jigsaw's, and since John Kramer's dead, this could be a copycat killer. They find the spiral painted on the courthouse wall, along with another box from Tiffany's wedged in the window. This one's got a tongue in it, like this were Blair Witch or some shit, as well as Detective Boswick's police badge. Zeke gets enraged because he was Boswick's friend, apparently not knowing that Bos was a corrupt cop who lied on the stand. When Zeke gets home, he pulls a gun on his dad.
You out of your fucking mind? I could've killed you.
What are you talking about? I got the gun.
I could've killed you.
Retired Police Chief Marcus Banks is played by Samuel L. Jackson, of course, who agreed to be in this movie because Chris Rock was a part of it. That means we get to hear him say lines like this.
Jigsaw copycat.
Yeah, Jigsaw! Glad Jackson's here for one of the funnier scenes of the film, as Zeke jokes about how distant his father is.
I saw you out front the other day. You nodded at me like we were the only two black guys in the mall.
Marcus leaves Zeke alone in his very Saw-style industrial apartment, and he flashes back to the time he turned in his corrupt partner. Zeke had found a man dead, shot by his partner Dunleavy, who lied and said it was done in self-defense. The detectives stew over the case in a scene that gives us our only helping of Tobin Bell in this installment. Hope you like these stills, they're all we're getting! While Zeke stays late looking at these red thread homeland boards, a cop named Fitch looks at Cityton's police state cameras. He recognizes the Uncle Sam who led Boz to the trap. It's a local drug addict named Benny Wright. Fitch goes to an abandoned building where Benny usually hangs, giving us more industrial Saw settings bathed in classic blue Saw light. Though Spiral occasionally emulates its predecessors with scenes that are blue or green, Bousman intentionally tried to differentiate its look to somewhat separate it from the series. That's why so many of the scenes are in crowds or take place during the day. It's in contrast to old Saw movies that feel much more claustrophobic. He also replaced shaky handheld shots and quick cuts with longer takes and fluid movements on steady cams and cranes. For a color palette, Bousman went with something warmer than usual to match the overbearing summer heat of Spiral's setting. Helping him with the look was cinematographer Jordan Oram, who had previously done short films and music videos for Drake. For his first feature film, Oram used sepia filters, glimmer glass, and Vaseline on the lenses.
Experimenting with filters. I've also put Vaseline on the lens a couple times, just to give a bit more texture to the film.
Fitch goes to wake Benny up, but instead gets all pinned! Then he gets bagged around the face and wakes up to find himself in a very wet and stretchy Saw trap. This one's got his fingers all tied up to some gears, and the pig on the TV screen tells him,
I want to play a game.
And then the screen goes black because this movie's editing is fucking weird. We don't see Fitch's death until later, after the fact, but I'll just show you what happens now. Makes more sense that way. Fitch was captured by the Jigsaw copycat killer because he once shot a man in cold blood for flipping him the bird. Now he's wearing finger traps.
Your finger pulled the trigger. And that cannot happen again.
If he bites down on the bars by his mouth, a machine will rip his fingers off and he'll be free to go. If not, zappy zappy. He bites down for a little bit, pulling him forward into the gears, and his fingers do indeed begin to tear off. But he stops to cry out, and that hesitation costs him dearly. Despite committing to the punishment thereafter, he's killed when the tub reaches the electrical coils around him. I guess when it came to escaping, he just couldn't figure it out. They had a hard time editing the finger trap, partly because there wasn't enough coverage of the water rising, partly because the MPAA made them cut out more than half the scene. As with all the traps, it was done practically. The digital work was limited to smoke, the eyes turning red, and cleaning up seams between the effects, like where actor Richard Zeppieri had his hands through holes in the table underneath prosthetic hands tied up in the trap. They filmed all 10 fingers being torn off, and though the MPAA made them cut it, at least it gave Bousman some souvenirs.
I actually took those fingers home with me on my carry-on bag, and they were pulled out at customs when I was going across the border from Canada back to the United States, and I had to explain to them why I had 10 fake fingers in my bag.
Zeke visits his dad's apartment, only to find that nobody's home. Earlier, Marcus was seen going into some building, but Zeke doesn't know about all that. Alone, he has another flashback to 12 years ago, where they hilariously try to de-age the characters with fake facial hair, bangs, and a backwards baseball cap. This feels like a college humor sketch. Or, you know, that scene in Saw 3D. We see that Marcus was pissed about Zeke turning in another cop, and that Garza promised Marcus she would help him deal with it. Okay, cool. Exposition acquired! You can leave this set now, Mr. Rock. Zeke gets another blue box, plugs another questionable flash drive into his work computer, and watches another video that features a Spiral. It's also got Mr. Snuggles, the new puppet in Spiral, who replaces Billy. But don't worry, Billy. We still love you, little guy. They recognize the video's background and head there, where they open a spiraled up truck to get pinned yet again! Stinker! They also find a box of fingers and Detective Fitch's police badge. We get another flashback, since this is Saw, after all, where we see that once upon a time, Zeke was in serious trouble. When he requested backup, Fitch purposefully ignored his call. That got Zeke a bullet in his stomach and Fitch an ass beating by then-Captain Marcus Banks. In the present, the police force finds Fitch's body and decides to keep pursuing his lead, namely Benny Wright. They go to where Benny buys his delicious drugs, and Zeke play acts as a potential buyer to trick the dealer. I think Zeke should have been an actor instead of a cop. He seems to really like the undercover stuff. His ruse blows a bunch of paint into the guy's eyes, giving Zeke and Shank a fighting chance when they storm the castle and bust down the dealer's door. Zeke plows the guy through a glass table that leaves his leg impaled. Oh damn. The drug dealer is played by popular YouTube magician Chris Ramsey. Bousman's a Magic fan and personally invited him to be part of the film. Ramsey has some awesome some videos on his channel from his time on set, including stuff about the stunts he did, like getting his face blasted with paint and going backwards through that table. Best of all, they let him keep the prosthetic he wears here, which was made from a mold of his leg.
Still smells like my leg.
Zeke tortures the guy through his injury, so what, he's not a cop who plays by the rules? The tactic works, and the dealer tells him that Benny Wrights hasn't been around lately. Damn, a dead end for your case. Maybe grab a bite to eat and think about it some more.
John Kramer didn't target cops.
Excuse me, sir? Some of John Kramer's biggest fucking targets were cops, dude. This is Detective Carey Erasure, and I won't stand for it. Zeke visits his ex-partner Pete Dunleavy, who served 9 years behind bars after Zeke refused to cover up for his murder. Another flashback shows why Dunleavy done did it. The guy he killed was witness to another cop's murder and was going to testify against him. Dunleavy backed his police bros, shot the guy, and framed him for murder. He probably should have taken an acting and or logic class, though.
He pulled a gun on me. The witness pulled a gun on you?
Huh, why's that hard to believe, Zeke? Dunleavy's sober now and, like, kind of apologetic.
Should have never pulled the trigger.
Guy had a family.
But the scene doesn't really do anything, so on we go! Another night with Daddy nowhere to be found. Another morning with another blue box delivery. This one's bigger and has a Mr. Snuggles inside, wrapped in human flesh like it were the goddamn Necronomicon. Zeke recognizes the skin as belonging to his rookie partner Shank, and after a little jump cut freakout, they find another clue to follow. It leads them to a butcher shop where they find a skinless body. A tape player nearby has a message addressed to Shank, and we see some quick bloody flashbacks, but not a full-on trap sequence like we got with the other two kills. Come on, show us the traps! The skinning scene was another instance where the MPAA cracked down hard, making things difficult for Bowsman and editor Dev Singh.
They don't give you a lot of guidance of what to do because they don't want to consider themselves a censorship board.
Bowsman thinks part of the pushback came because this was a more mainstream Saw film. Chris Rock and Sam Jackson might bring in a broader audience. He says an entire trap had to be removed, one in which they ripped a guy's face off. He wouldn't say which character's death it was, but my guess is Detective Drury, who's shown and mentioned a few times before kind of just disappearing from the movie. Garza gets a text from the missing Marcus telling her to check out something in the evidence locker. Wait, why does that door say Vincent Jules? Did y'all do that for Sammy J? Well, I hope he liked it. The Pulp Fiction door slams shut and Garza gets gasified, knocking her unconscious so she can get
up here.
She wakes up with wet paper towel on her face and a tape recorder playing. It admonishes her for covering up corruption in the police force, then reveals one of the nastiest trap conditions I've ever heard.
The only way to stop yourself from being suffocated is to sever your spinal cord.
Damn, man, cutting off a body part is standard Saw trap payment. But for some reason, it feels more extreme to paralyze a person from the neck down. She goes for it anyway, but it doesn't work out. And by the time Zeke finds her, she's suffocated and smoking. You know, I bet all that wax would actually be pretty fun to peel. Oh, nope, it's taking the skin with it. Never mind, don't like that. Damn, dude, still giving her mouth to mouth? Zeke's a hero. Zeke has another jump cut hissy fit and tries to figure out, oh, I'm peeing! Now we jump back to finish that scene with Marcus that started nearly 40 minutes ago. This movie's structure is so weird. I'm not sure if they ran into a problem during editing or what, but you know what? At least we get Sam Jackson saying the lines we want to hear.
You want to play games, motherfucker? Alright, I'll play.
Haha, yeah, you'll play, dude. A round of face snatching and air shooting. Now we're back to Zeke, who wakes up in such an OG Saw position that it calls for a rendition of Hello Zep, the only music cue to return from the previous Saw films. Hello Zep was composed by Charlie Clouser, former keyboardist for Nine Inch Nails. It's one of my favorite horror themes. Clouser has worked on every Saw film, and much like Bowsman's direction, his work in Spiral perfectly balances new and familiar. Zeke gets himself free the easy way and discovers his ex-partner Pete Dunleavy chained up. Wait, that's Pete?
Pete?
I guess so. I didn't recognize him because every time this character shows up, he looks like he's played by a different actor. Another tape recording tells Zeke that he can save Dunleavy or let him face punishment for his murder. And punishment in this case means a hurricane of glass going into the guy. Is this a real thing? A glass bottle pitching machine? Seems like a messy way to recycle, but I guess if it's saving the planet. On set, they used real glass and plexiglass for the shots of the bottles. When actors were involved, they used rubber glass instead.
But that hurts, by the way, because it's being shot out. It's being shot out by air cannons.
Though Zeke tries his hardest to free Dunleavy, it's too late. The guy has been flayed to death by flying glass. Maybe don't keep touching him, Zeke. Gonna get glass in your hand. Eh, probably doesn't matter. He's got glass everywhere. Zeke continues onward until this movie's pretty obvious obvious plot twist is revealed. It's been Detective William Shank the whole time. Yeah, clearly it's the guy whose death we never saw explicitly. Turns out that skinned body belonged to missing drug addict Benny Wright, so I'll go ahead and put him on the kill count now. I didn't put up a kill graphic when they found the body to keep the mystery going, you know, just for fun. We see that Shank, real name Emerson, was a young boy when he saw his father murdered by Dunleavy. Zeke protected the young Shank, who then devoted his life to joining the force and becoming Zeke's partner. He still wants to be partners, in fact. After all, Zeke stood up to corrupt cops, and Shank has shown that he too is against corrupt cops, very violently so.
You want me to help you kill cops?
No, fuck no. Just the bad ones.
Zeke says he'll go along with it, but before Shank can trust his sincerity, he'll have to pass one final test. That test involves his dad, Marcus Banks, suspended above the ground with his blood leaking into jars. Shank has called the police and told them there's a crazy guy with a gun, and they're pulling up outside, putting a time limit on Zeke's decision. The gun he holds has a single bullet. If he shoots a target, his dad will be set free, but Shank will be able to escape. If he shoots Shank, his dad will die.
So, probably shoot the target, right?
Shank talks about how Zeke's dad was king of corruption when he was police chief, so what? Is he trying to convince Zeke to shoot him and let his dad die? I don't really understand the drama here.
That's what cops do. Shoot first, ask questions later.
No, yeah, I get the moralizing, I just don't get the motivation of this ultimatum. Zeke shoots the target because, da-doy, and as promised, Marcus drops to the ground. After checking on him, Zeke pounces on Shank, so he's busy as the SWAT team buzzsaws through the door. It cuts a tripwire that Shank had set up, and Marcus is pulled off the ground, looking like a puppet. All while Hello Zep kicks into full swing, and we get some elucidating flashbacks.
Your dad's the reason for all of this. That's why I want to do this in the first place.
The SWAT team gets inside, and a mechanism pushes a gun into Marcus's hand. The symbolism is apparent as the officers open fire, tearing Marcus Banks to pieces while his son Zeke screams in agony. The movie ends with Shank shushing Zeke as he gets away, and the credits play over 21 Savage's kick-ass Spiral song.
How many lives spiraled into death and onto the kill count? Let's find out and... Oh. Oh no!
Eight people died in Spiral, with the victims consisting of seven men and only a single woman. Really scaled back the killing here. The last three Saw movies had double-digit kills. With a runtime of 93 minutes, that left us with a kill on average every 11.63 minutes. I'll give the golden chainsaw for coolest kill to Captain Garza. Suffocating in hot wax is horrific and new to me. Closest thing I can think of is that creepy kill in Tourist Trap. Doll Machete for Lamest kill will go to the driver that Detective Fitch murdered, shot by a bastard off-screen. And lest we forget, Saw movies have their own awards. I'll give the platinum punji sticks for coolest trap to the Finger Puller 9000. It's elaborate, yet gives the victim a simple out. Bite down, motherfucker! Rusty Mousetrap for Lamest Trap will go to the glass throwing thing. Felt like not enough time to get Dunleavy down, and you know, it's just chucking glass shards at him. And that's it. Spiral from the Book of Saw was finished days before the COVID-19 lockdowns began. Rather than release it on streaming services, they waited a full year to release it in theaters. But it still wound up with the lowest box office of the franchise. Until next time, I'm James A. Janisse. This has been the Kill Count.
On the next Kill Count.
Old Fred Krueger was lurking around Elm Street like it was a kid's playground. When suddenly Jason burst on the scene, started killing everybody like a machine. Fred Krueger got pissed and he turned to pinball, then learned Jason's weakness was a waterfall. But what he didn't count on was the final girl taking him to real life and saying,
"Welcome to my world!
This is the ultimate matchup. Ultimate killer guys, rule for good stunts and bad characters. Into the air they'll fly. The fact it actually happened is kind of a surprise. This is the ultimate matchup.
Ultimate killer guys."
It's all coming apart again.
Freddy vs. Jason can currently be watched on the pictured streaming platforms. Demi always recommends you watch the movie for yourself before its kill count. It's the only way to have your own properly informed opinion. Kill counts are never meant to replace the experience of watching a film.
Thanks a lot for watching this extra kill count. I want to thank some patrons like Huynh Thuy Dao, Michael Williams, Ali, Jackson Stewart, Andrew Gray, Knife Sponge, and Yason. I remember how happy I was to finish the Saw series in 2018. Dude, back then I didn't even go into behind the scenes. It's just those movies' plots were so complicated, it still took a lot out of me. Modern kill counts of the Saw movies would probably be like 40 minutes each. Let's not do that though, all right? Thanks everyone. Be good people.